Welcome to Sunday Night Live, the online television magazine series for Christians across the UK. In the programme today, the Lindisfarne Gospels, 1300 years old but still touching minds, hearts and souls. Today's children sing out their concerns to the G7 summit leaders. Sponsor a child and change a life. And we remember David Sheppard, batting for England and batting for the poor. And if you find the programme today interesting, well, please remember to press the subscribe and the like buttons so that you'll be reminded of the programme next week and more people will get the chance to watch it. Hello again from me, Pam Rhodes, with a programme that's very varied today, something for everyone, I think. And this first song is definitely for everyone everywhere because it was specially written for the leadership conference that took place a few weeks back that brought together church leaders from across the continents to share time, vision and prayer to transform our nations, our churches and our society. And I have a feeling you might find yourself joining in with this song too.
He's got the whole world in his hands. He's got the whole world in his hands.
He's got the whole world in his hands.
He's got the whole world in his hands.
Sari duniya ko usne thama hai.
You're not distant.
Some know that you're with me, you're near me, you're for me.
And I know that you're listening and leading and loving.
And I pray that you'll hear me and free me and carry.
And I know that you're with me, you're near me, and you're for me.
When I'm lonely, console me. When I'm searching and I'm hurting, oh, I know that you're with me. And you're near me, and you're for me, Lord.
Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness.
My God, that is true.
Wake up.
Well, those church leaders would have been acutely aware of the shocking rise in the number of people at risk across the world of starvation, a number which has doubled to more than 270 million since the start of the pandemic. And every single person represented in that terrible number is a father, a mother, a child. The Christian charity Compassion UK is constantly working to support families in the world's poorest communities. And one way which has been found to really make an impact on breaking that cycle of poverty is when a caring person from a country like ours commits to sponsoring and taking a long-term interest in the potential and the care of one particular child in need. Johnny Alarm was sponsored when he was young, and he looks back now on how that sponsorship helped him to find freedom from poverty and hope where there had been none.
My name is Johnny Alarm. I come from a small slum community of 10,000 people. Shared two toilets and one tap. The magnitude of the problem is massive. 1.5 million people living in slum dwellings and caught up in this vicious cycle of poverty. But change is possible, and I know that because it happened to me. As a young boy, I looked around. What I saw was people starving, people suffering, people powerless to do anything to help themselves. When it rained, the city was flooded, so was our community. I grew up with diseases like malaria, dengue, diarrhea, losing friends to these diseases. People think poverty is just lack of resources, material, food. It's not just that. Poverty is the state of hopelessness, the state of powerlessness. It's being scared to dream in life. One day, everything changed for me and my family. My father found out about some people who were helping slum children, and he took me there, and I got sponsored through Compassion.
Compassion gives children all over the world the chance to go to school, eat nutritious meals, receive medical checkups, learn life skills, and be part of the local church. Compassion works in partnership with the local church, who are best positioned to know and meet the specific needs of their community. Together, the local church and the sponsor help to release a child from poverty.
I've never met my sponsor in person, but he wrote me letters constantly, telling me that he loves me, he prays for me, he cares about me, asking about my family. I used to do little paintings and sketches for him. Over the years, we've developed this relationship, which makes me feel very loved and special. I was the first child in my community of 10,000 people to actually go to school. I think it really empowered me to make positive changes, not just in my life, but my family's and my community as well. By God's grace, I managed to score the highest marks in my school. I studied business. I did a bachelor's in business administration. And then I got an offer from Manchester University. And in December 2014, I graduated with a first class master's degree in international business. I look back, I am very thankful to God for what He has done in my life, but I am very excited because I believe He has equipped me to make a positive change in someone else's life. I have become a sponsor myself now. I'm sponsoring a little girl who lives in a slum dwelling made up of abandoned drain pipes. I'm looking forward to writing letters and investing in her life and journeying with her to see how she flourishes and breaks herself and her family from the vicious cycle of poverty. My sponsor has completely transformed my life. And to be very honest, it really scares me to think what my life would have been, where I would have been, had he not chosen to sponsor me that day.
It's always an interesting experience to look back, as Jane did then, to remember how you felt when you were a child. And that's something that Welsh songwriter Mal Pope has been thinking about too, that the child you were is right at the heart of the adult you've become.
as I rest my head to sleep, I pray the Lord my soul to keep. And if that he should come before I awake, my soul to take up above a world of love, I should be for eternity safe above, safe in love in heaven. As I rest my head to sleep, I think about the people that I meet, and they don't seem to have the time to say hello, to say goodbye. They don't even seem to care. They don't think God is anywhere. But I'm in love, safe above in heaven. As I rest my head to sleep, I think about the child I used to be. A simple faith gets torn apart, and disappointments break a heart. But looking deeper when I can, I see the child inside the man. Still in love, safe above in heaven.
Well, the children and young people in Cornwall have been giving a lot of thought to their future too, especially as the G7 summit meeting of world leaders will be taking place in Carbis Bay next weekend from Friday the 11th to Sunday the 13th of June. And because those young people feel that what's being discussed at the summit is of much more importance to them than to anyone in our generation, they have poured their thoughts and feelings into a song, Sing to G7, just to make sure those world leaders get their message.
So it's a song about the environment and how 7 is linked to a lot of things in on our earth, rainbows. In a video we watched about it, I think it mentioned something about 7 metals or 7 minerals.
If more schools and children talk about it, maybe they will listen and change something about it.
If you just say it, it's just like a bit boring, and a song gives it more emphasis and makes it sound more better.
Well, we're about to hear that song, Sing to G7, recorded by the choristers at Truro Cathedral. But this song will echo around the world, sung by at least 25,000 young voices in video recordings that have come from 27 different countries. It is an ambitious but really worthwhile project, and it's taken a lot of organising.
Hello, my name's Esme Page. I'm one of the organisers of Sing to G7. So how did it begin? Well, it was deep, dark January, lockdown, and G7 was announced in Cornwall. Not really the sort of place you expect all the world leaders to descend. And Christopher Gray, who's the director of music at the cathedral, Truro Cathedral, and I got our thinking caps on, because we felt the leaders are coming and our children have a lot to say, but how do we actually get that across? How do we get their voices heard? These leaders are meeting just around the corner, but they could remain completely oblivious to what our children want to say. So we thought, let's do a song. And we asked Sir Tim Rice, and he was willing to write the lyrics. He's the patron of the choir. And Peter Hobbs wrote the music. We got a website going and people started signing up. We are heading now right towards G7, which starts on the 11th of June. We are going to be having a mega Zoom because 25,000 voices so far have signed up to sing G7. And we want to bring all of those together from all around the world, 27 countries. For us, this is a very practical way for the choristers of actually acting out the last verse of the song, which says, "Let nation speak to nation. Don't let the others down. Don't forget the not so fortunate, or we'll run you out of town." There's a bit of a sting in the tale of Sir Tim's words. But it is that piece around don't let the others down, don't forget the not so fortunate, that the choristers have really taken to heart, as have hundreds and hundreds of schools and choirs and churches in the UK, but also all across the world. So if you would like to join in, all you need to do is to go to singtog7.org. All the free resources are there. The sheet music, backing track, tutorials by Christopher Gray, the director of music at Truro Cathedral. And then also on the education page, just all these wonderful lessons about the G7, about the countries, and a module about leadership, which helps children discover their leadership qualities, including servant leadership as a concept. But also art, G7 in art, G7 in maths. It's a real treasure trove for teachers, and mainly for primary school kids, because we felt that kids in that age group have very little way to get themselves heard by leaders. People are posting their versions of the G7 song, hashtagging us in Sing to G7. And you can look on our Facebook, Twitter, and so on. And it would be wonderful if people can help us connect and encourage the young people as they get their voices heard.
Jesus,
Still to come on Sunday Night Live, coping with change when you're beginning to feel your age. 1300 years on, celebrating the beauty and the inspiration of the Lindisfarne Gospels. And the search is on for the BBC Young Chorister of the Year. Do you remember David Sheppard? And if so, do you think of him on the cricket pitch batting for England? Or like me, do you remember him as the Anglican bishop in Liverpool back in the 80s when he formed a remarkable and very productive partnership with the Roman Catholic bishop of the same time, Derek Warlock? And between them, the two men did so much to end the deep religious division that had existed in that city for almost two centuries. Well, David died back in 2005, but it is a mark of how well respected he still is that Desmond Tutu has just written the foreword for a new biography of David's life, Batting for the Poor. And here's the man that wrote that book, Andrew Bradstock.
Batting for the Poor wasn't actually my choice of title for the book, but it does wonderfully capture the essence of the man at the heart of it, David Sheppard. It also reminds us that he had two careers, one in cricket and one in the church, where as a bishop he had a heart for what he called God's bias to the poor. Those two careers actually overlapped for a time, and David Sheppard is still the only ordained minister to have played Test cricket, which might be a good question for your next church quiz. I came to write David Sheppard's biography following an unexpected conversation with his daughter Jenny, who kindly gave me access to her late father's papers, which meant I could write the authorised biography, which was a huge privilege. It came out 18 months ago and it's just been reissued in paperback. I'll say something in a moment about the background to David Sheppard's transition from the crease to the pulpit, if you like. But if I had to sum up his remarkable career, the words that spring to mind are leadership, courage, and faith. I mean, David Sheppard showed leadership actually as a cricketer. He captained England for a time. But it was when he went to Liverpool as bishop in the mid-1970s that his leadership skills really came to the fore. He was there for 22 years, and during that time he forged a remarkable and path-breaking partnership with his Roman Catholic opposite number, Archbishop Derek Warlock. And the two of them brought lasting change to a city that was really in dire straits when they went there in the mid-1970s. For example, Liverpool had an extraordinarily high rate of unemployment, and the bishops worked with local businesses to create jobs, you know, attract inward investment. There were a lot of underlying social tensions in Liverpool which would spill over, most famously in Toxteth. And after that, the bishops worked with the police and the black community to try and reach a just reconciliation. In some ways, David Sheppard and Derek Warlock were ambassadors for Liverpool, representing its interest to central government in London at a time when local government in Liverpool had rather fallen apart. I suppose their most obvious lasting legacy to the city was the way in which, by working so publicly together, they helped to bring to an end two centuries of quite bitter sectarian division. So the fact that Liverpool today is such a vibrant city is due in no small part to the contribution of the bishops and their belief in the gospel of hope and reconciliation that can bring change to people's lives. The courage comes in when you think of the challenges that David Sheppard took on. Again, he'd shown courage as a cricketer in the 1960s. He was pretty much a lone voice in the cricket community in calling for a sporting boycott of South Africa during the apartheid years. This lost him a lot of friends, although one person whose respect he gained was no less a person than Archbishop Desmond Tutu, who has kindly written the foreword to my book. David Sheppard also had the courage to stand up to the government if he felt they were acting in an unchristian way, neglecting the poor and the needy. For example, he was behind the Faith in the City report, which challenged the government in the 1980s for its lack of interest in the inner city. The roots of David Sheppard's courage were undoubtedly in his strong Christian faith, his belief in God and in the power of the gospel to transform people inwardly and outwardly. And he came to faith in quite a remarkable way. As a student at Cambridge, he went to an evangelistic rally. and he'd always been brought up to go to church, but the message that evening was, you need a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. And David Sheppard heard that message and responded to it, and it turned his life around. He stepped back from the possibility of a glittering career in cricket and felt increasingly a call to ordination in the church, and the rest is history. Just in passing, one of the delights of writing a biography is that you get to meet so many interesting people. And I actually met three people who were there at that evening in Cambridge in November 1949, who remembered it vividly and the impact it had on David Sheppard, and shared their memories with me, which was a huge privilege. I wrote the book not just to record a great life. I think David Sheppard is an example of principled leadership, and it's good to be reminded of that. And also, at a time when the Christian faith is sometimes portrayed in a rather negative way, David Sheppard is an example of someone who, from a Christian perspective, was able to bring very positive change to the lives of people, both individually and as a community. So I think there's much we can learn from, and indeed be encouraged by, in the life and witness of David Sheppard.
Hundred years ago, on Holy Island, off the northeast coast of England, the monk who was acknowledged as the writer of the Lindisfarne Gospels died, having devoted his life to producing this beautiful work that tells the story of Jesus. Well, our own Ian Britton has been along to talk to the vicar of St Mary's Church on Holy Island now to find out why these ancient Gospels are so significant.
1300 years ago that Eadfrith, who wrote the Gospels, died. So he died in the year 721. 1300 years ago, quite some time.
So you live and serve on Holy Island, you're the vicar there. How have the Lindisfarne Gospels touched your own life?
So the Lindisfarne Gospels have touched my own life as vicar here, serving this community in different ways. I mean, they're the most beautiful book. To see the Gospels, the story of Jesus and the parables and all of the, you know, all of the writings of the Gospels set out in that way is absolutely spiritually quite breathtaking.
The original Gospels are in the British Library, so when people come to the Holy Island of Lindisfarne, what can they see and what can they experience?
So in our heritage centre, which is run by the Islands Community Development Trust, in the Heritage Centre, there's a facsimile of the Gospels, and it's on the computer, so you can turn the pages and see different pages of it. It's absolutely really worth coming and looking at that. And also in the Heritage Centre, there's a whole story in the history of the island, from the ancient saints through the troubles with the Vikings, which is why the book had to leave with St Cuthbert. And of course, St Mary's Church and the Priory, the church where the Gospels were written, overlooking St Cuthbert's Island, absolutely beautiful. The sense of spiritual Christian heritage and Christian history here, as I'm sure many people know, is very special. Come and feel some of that peace that Christ gives us.
Have you got a young person in your church choir that you think could become the BBC Young Chorister of the Year? Because the search is on to find our most talented boy and girl choristers. But they will have to apply very quickly because the closing date is Monday the 14th of June. They can apply online and send in two short videos of them singing sacred songs, a carol, a hymn, a classical solo, gospel, spiritual. The choice is theirs. But we will all be able to see the competition on Songs of Praise in October and hear it too on BBC Radio 2. But we're going to hear now from two of the past Young Choristers of the Year, along with the nation's favourite grown-up choir boy, leading 250 cathedral choristers across the country who just want to sing forever. Well, the subject of our reflection this week might well ring bells with many of us who find that we're marking anniversaries of important events in our lives that now seem so long ago. How the years fly and how things change. Well, we're going to hear from someone who's not quite sure he's ready for too much change.
Hello, my name is John Claydon. I'm a regional minister for the Northern Baptist Association. That is, I provide pastoral support, encouragement and leadership for Baptist churches in the north of England. 50 years ago this weekend, I experienced a significant change in life. I left school on the Friday, and on the Monday I started work as an apprentice electrician. Later I trained as a Baptist minister, and now after many years in ministry, I face another change. It's the R word, retirement. Change is something we love talking about. Indeed, we love to moan about it. We're less good at celebrating it. We have our set phrases, don't we? No one likes change. We say, I don't like change. Or a change is as good as a rest. We live in changing times, we say. Change is constant. It's always happening. Now, you don't have to agree with me, but I want to offer a few reflections. I want to suggest that change is natural, it's historical, and it's part of God's plan. It's natural. Just think of the seasons as one season gives way to another. Winter to spring to summer and to autumn. We live in that constant state of change. Think of geography. How we go and we travel, perhaps from the coast to the rolling countryside to the majestic mountains. It's a natural part of life, isn't it? From struggling to sit up as babies to all that we can do when we grow older is to sit in a chair. It's natural in knowledge as we learn and develop, and we give thanks for the change that's taken place in learning how to find vaccines for the COVID-19 pandemic that we're in. It's natural to God, who is always the same and yet ever creative. And so it's natural to the life and the mission of the church as we learn to demonstrate God's love and share his good news to each generation. It's natural. It's also historical. We live in changing times, we say, but who hasn't? There have been different types of change. There are incremental changes that take place. There are big revolutionary changes that take place. And changes in all sorts of things, from transport to education to health, justice, culture, even entertainment. I'm one of five siblings, and between us we cover 20 years. That means when we get together and talk, we draw from different decades, from the 50s and 60s and 70s as being our childhood. There are some things we share in common, but over those decades, some of the norms in eating, in schooling, and in work changed, and changed quite significantly. Back in the 1960s, Bob Dylan sang, "The times they are a-changing." Was it prophetic? Was it anticipation of what was to happen? Was it an observation of what was happening? I just want to give a bit of heresy, if you like, that change was not new, even for Bob Dylan. Because we've always lived in changing times. Yes, the 60s were a specific time of change, but actually so were the 1950s that went from the end of rationing to the end of conscription. And the 1940s that went from the horror of war to health provision for all. Every decade, every century has its own change. Change is here to stay, and it always has been. It's natural. But how it happens and how we respond to it is significantly important. The best change comes when it builds on the past, when it happens with a sense of security, when there are those things that can help us to navigate the process of change, those things that make us feel secure, just as the child who learns to ride a bike has stabilizers to make that change into riding a bike. So we need those things that help us to navigate times of change. And good change requires trust. Trust in perhaps a teacher or a trainer or a leader. Change is also part of God's plan. It's there in creation. It's there in history. It's there in our personal walk with Him. In the life that we live, in the life and mission of the church, what we do and who we are and how we are is constantly changing. Change is part of God's plan. It's a natural expression of our creativity. And so we sing the old and we sing the new. We draw on a range of songs, of hymns, of activities and insights. Change is an expression of a living relationship with a creative and dynamic God. And it's matched by inner renewal. So for me, change is in the air. Retirement beckons. It's a new calling with new opportunities. But you will have your own changes to navigate. Perhaps it's moving back into church, moving into meeting people personally. Now that hugs are allowed, how does that feel? Moving into a new chapter of your life, in the life of your church. And an opportunity to take the old, take the learned, and take that which is yet to be learned, and to move on. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And yet He is the Lord of change and transformation. And so we walk into the new. We walk into change with trust, with love, with hope, with joy. And whatever you are facing, may you know the blessing of God, of His love, His peace, and His joy.
Well, some really constructive and helpful thoughts there from the Reverend John Claydon from the Northern Baptist Association. And John will be leading us all in prayer in just a few minutes at the end of Sunday Night Live for this week. I hope you've enjoyed it. And if you do have any comments you'd like to share, well, please do that online so that others can join in the conversation, or you can contact us direct. Details of both come up at the end of the programme. But I do hope that you will be able to tune in again next weekend. I'll look forward to that. In the meantime, this is Pam Rhodes wishing you well and hoping that you will look after yourselves and each other. Until then, bye-bye now.
Loving God, ever faithful one, we thank you for the dynamic, recreative power of your Spirit. Renew us afresh in the power of that Spirit. Grant us creativity of mind and graciousness of heart. Equip us for the changes of our times and lead us on in the security of your love. And in living each day, grant to us your blessing. In the name of Jesus Christ we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
And if you've enjoyed Sunday Night Live, don't forget to press the subscribe and like buttons so that your device will offer you future editions each week, and recognise that this is a programme of interest to you and others.